The principal passenger locomotive for the L&N Railroad in the 1900s, turn of the century, was their 10-wheeler. As trains got heavier, they decided that they needed something better, so the Pacific, being the new wheel arrangement coming into vogue then, was selected, and they asked the Rogers Locomotive Works in Paterson, New Jersey, to build them 5 prototypes of this particular wheel arrangement, and they did in 1905.
It was built as a, at that time, frontline passenger locomotive, because it was, it had 2 extra wheels, which the older previous passenger engines didn't have, namely the 2 wheels underneath the firebox, which were known as a trailing truck. It was used on the L&N for a number of years as a frontline engine. And then, of course, as time went on, the demand for motive power became greater, so this engine was relegated to lesser service.
The locomotive had been stored outside since 1957, and the weather had completely deteriorated the jacket to the extent that when we took it off, it wasn't even usable for patterns. And the water that had run down behind the jacket and wet the asbestos had rusted out so many stay bolt sleeves that it required almost a complete replacement of all flexible stay bolts.
The overall lines of the engine remained the same as we wanted them to. The typical high stack of an engine of this era, and the size and other features. But the thing that makes it a modern engine are some of the appliances that we added for safety as well as other considerations. The cross-compound air compressor is a much higher capacity than the original air compressors on the engine. The power reverse was definitely a safety a feature which we added. The low water alarm was a safety feature. We're real happy with it. We have the classic lines of the engine, but yet we have a modern performing engine. The tender which we have on this engine now is an L&N tender. However, it's off of a larger class engine, namely an L1, which is a 482 wheel arrangement, 2 extra driving wheels over this engine. The L1s were probably, for all practical purposes, the replacements for these engines in frontline passenger service on the L&N Railroad.
Okay, Ben, your cover.
The original shakedown run for the 152 took place on September 26, 1985, but ended in failure 31 miles out when the journals on the first and third drivers overheated and the 462 had to be pulled back to the museum. After bearings were remachined and a different kind of grease cake was applied, another shakedown run was scheduled for October 26. This video covers that trip. The museum's BL2 came along for the ride just in case of trouble.
something that comes over you when you sit down in the engineer's seat in an engine that's under steam that really can't be described unless you've actually experienced it yourself. And you snatch out on the throttle and this thing responds to you. It's really a feeling of power that's undescribable. Other people have tried to describe it, and each one of them does it different. It's an amazing, amazing feeling. And once you've done it, you've become addicted.
First engine that that I've fired personally, and for any length of time, it certainly is a real education. There's certainly more than just throwing the coal through the door. You have to physically place the coal throughout the interior of this firebox on these grates. The manuals on firing say that the if you're working yourself to death, you're not firing properly. So no, it's a question of technique. More so than physical labor, although in the learning process, it's very much physical labor as well.
That I would see it in steam. You know, all those years we worked on it, I never was discouraged by it. It was a long time, but it was worth it. There's nothing like it. It's hard work. But when you're running along and hearing that exhaust talk to you and the whistle blow, there's nothing like it. I like the whistle better than any whistle I've heard. It's a high-pitched whistle, not too low. It just has a very good sound.